Where do our loyalties lie?
So why Ahmadiyya?
They're not fanatics, they're sick.
To make a better world for everyone.
With real stories.
You know, there's nothing that I've done differently, I've just been me.
Real issues.
Is it possible to be loyal to two different countries?
Real views. This is Real Talk Canada.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another edition of Real Talk Canada. We're here from the Tahir Hall in Peace Village for today's show. I hope you've been enjoying our series so far, and don't forget you can always catch up on previous episodes of the program by visiting our official website. The details are there for you at the bottom of the screen. You can find out what we'll be discussing in the future as well, so you can always put forward your points of view. Now on today's show we're going to be having a look at education amongst our youth. Unfortunately, in today's modern world, 101 million youngsters are still without access to education. And this also leads to the question that those of us who do live in countries where we do have access to education, are we really making the most of it? And do we value education? Well, to help answer these questions and much more, I'm joined by an expert panel. So let me start by first introducing them. Firstly, I'm joined by Mubarak Nazir Saab. Assalamu alaikum, welcome to Real Talk. Mubarak Saab is a missionary in charge for Jamaat Ahmadiyya here in Canada. Next, I'm joined by Ijaz Rauf Saab. Assalamu alaikum, welcome to Real Talk. Ijaz Saab is the Secretary for Education here in Canada for the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. Next, I'm joined by Abdulwahid Saab. Welcome to Real Talk, who's currently studying a Master's in Education and is also an elementary school teacher. And last but not least, I'm joined by Dawn Phillips. Welcome to Real Talk, pleasure to have you here. And Dawn's an instructor at the University of Toronto, Mississauga, and currently is a coordinator for the Science Education Minor Program. It's a pleasure to have all of you. Thank you for joining us. And as usual, we're joined by our studio audience here, who will be adding in their points of view throughout the program. Now, before we start the discussion here in the studio, let's get a whole general perspective on the topic at large. Let's take a listen to the word on the street.
Education, by definition, is the process of giving and receiving systematic instruction. But wouldn't you have to be educated to know that? We can look at all the statistics we want, such as the fact that in most North American cities, the dropout rate can be as high as 50%. But the real picture is right in front of our eyes. Look around your high school, your college or university campus. Are the classrooms full? How many students are skipping class? What is the value of education today? It is a puzzle that cannot be solved by even the most intellectual in today's modern world. Going to school, getting an education to ensure a future nowadays has become a laughable notion. But what are the root causes for this way of thought? So much is made of the media's influence on today's youth, yet nowhere in mainstream media can we find anything which really endorses or encourages education. Rather, the complete opposite is insinuated and even at times outright encouraged. Just look at one of the most famous athletes in the world. LeBron James is one of the most notable players in the National Basketball Association. Now, when researching him, it'll be easy to find what high school he went to. But it's impossible to find the college or university attended. That's because there is none. James went straight into the NBA after his final year of high school, foregoing a post-secondary education. Now over the span of 4 years, his salary is about $14.5 million, which isn't even including the millions more he makes off of all of his endorsements. So now without a college or university education, LeBron James is one of the highest paid athletes in the world. Evidently, therefore, in today's materialistic world, whatever makes you more money fast is the way to go. You don't need to go to school if you can make millions without an education. That is what our society has come to today. What's more, there are people in third world and developing countries who would give anything for just even a day of school. Whereas here, education holds no more value. With all these thoughts in our minds and all these questions left unanswered, we've come here to York University to see what students think about the value of education. We're here to get the word on the street.
I think we take it a lot for granted, especially say in the
more elementary years. Something like university or college, people don't take as granted because, you know, it comes out of our own pockets. But I would say for definitely elementary school and high school, people take it really for granted, and they even like dread it sometimes and say, "Oh, I hate school," but really they don't know what they're getting. And there are people in other parts of the world who would die for that kind of education. So it's really something to appreciate.
A lot of people in third world countries, they have to work really hard to even get an education. Well, for us, it's kind of automatically given to us before university. And a lot of people, I guess, slack off and don't do as much work because they kind of take it for granted as if it's always been there as part of our society.
In the media today, we see people, you know, who might not have a post-secondary education who are making millions of dollars. What do you think about that? Do you think that's fair? Do you think that, you know, that's kind of leading society in another direction away from education?
No, I think that there's some people that they can basically figure things out for themselves, and they can figure how, let's say, how to sell a really good product and get lucky in life, and that's fine. If you're lucky and smart enough to come up with a product that gets you to the millions, that's fine, but some people have to do the work for it.
Personally, education is not what many people would think of, going to school, getting good grades. I do think going to school is great, and I do think that, but education is just learning and higher knowledge. When I go to class and I sit through, I'm not always thinking about getting the best mark or getting the best job, but actually learning and absorbing the knowledge from class.
Does education still have the same value in our society that it used to before, or is it kind of declining? What do you think about that?
It's still important, I guess, but in a very different way. Like, there's so much emphasis placed on a university degree that we forget about the importance of trade skills, because now, like, university degrees are useless except for the fact that it, you know, you can't get a job with that one, but yet you don't have any practical skills with it.
As time progresses and, you know, parents are keep harping on kids to go get higher education and higher grades, that a degree, an undergrad degree, doesn't mean as much as it does mean years ago, and as it goes on, you need to go get higher and higher levels of education, especially as society progresses and our knowledge base increases as a society, you know.
That was the word on the street, and I hope that's just sort of built up the whole discussion. And let's start it off in the studio here. Dawn, if I could just turn to you first. We're looking at education from a global perspective, and do you think youngsters around the world actually value education? What's your view on that?
Youngsters tend to value education more if they live in places where people are starving to death because of lack of it. When you live in a country like Canada where that isn't happening, you will find that there are many young people who do not appreciate and realize the value of it.
Okay. Ijaz, I'm just turning to you as well. Obviously, you're the National Secretary for Education within the community as well. How do you actually put forward that message to make sure that youngsters value education?
You know, Don has put it very rightly that it is value is very subjective. It's of great value where it is, there is a scarcity of it, and it is of very little value, or the society defines it differently, where there is abundance of it, like in Canada. So for youth, you know, I've seen in many different times, people have been traveling from places to places, miles for in search of education, in search of knowledge, but some people, you know, for some people, it is not as valuable as to those who don't have it.
Okay. Mubarak Nazis, I'm just turning to you. I mean, as far as I understand, you've actually spent some time in Africa as well. What's the difference in terms of the way people value education in different countries?
I have worked in Africa, in West Africa, for as many as 28 years.
Really?
Okay. And I have worked in schools, senior schools, junior schools, and I have just returned also from one of those West African countries, and that country is called Sierra Leone. And I still saw people and girls walking maybe 7 miles, 10 miles every day just to go to their primary school and gain education. There is, and you see on the lorries over there, on the trucks over there, sometimes you read the slogan, knowledge is power. Islam has laid great stress on education. The Holy Prophet said that a Muslim is a student from the cradle to the grave.
Okay.
And he also said that if you have to seek knowledge, and even if you have to go to China, you must go to China to seek knowledge.
Waitab, just turning to you, I mean, is that something that you maybe could actually relate to with hearing there of youngsters walking miles and miles just to get primary level education, and you working in an elementary school? The youngsters there, do you think they're maybe forced into education? Is it something they actually want to do?
Well, it was a nice little segue from Mubarak Nazir Saab about China and how I had experience teaching in China for a little bit. Here in Canada, though, I've seen that in the elementary level and also in secondary, there are definitely students who do value education. And that comes from, you know, their upbringing, from the parents, and also, you know, kind of the emphasis that society puts on education here.
So why, by just turning to you, I mean, is that something that you can relate to what Mubarak Nazir Saab just said about youngsters valuing education so much that they're willing to walk for miles and miles? And obviously you're teaching in an elementary school, and what do you think about the youngsters who actually go to your school? Do they really value education?
From my experience at the elementary level and also seeing what happens at the secondary level, it's pretty clear that the students here, at least in Canada and North America, definitely value their education, you know, because of, and I think that comes from the family upbringing and also from the emphasis that society puts on them to have that education. On the other side of the fence, there are students who don't value their education.
I mean, looking at your biography, you've actually taught in China as well, and it'll be interesting to know, because we're looking at education from a global perspective in this first half of the program, what have been your experiences in some of the differences maybe between working in China and in Canada in terms of education?
There's a large number of differences between the education in China and in Canada. I mean, for one, there's teaching styles. There's different teaching styles from how the teachers teach the students. Mm-hmm. The students act differently.
In what way? Can you just elaborate?
You know, in the classroom, it could be simple, small things as when they're told to give an answer, or when they are giving an answer, they would stand and give that answer and then sit right back down. There's so many things where, you know, there's the obedience that the students have towards their, and the respect towards their teachers, mm-hmm. who are very much mentors to them, you know, in China. And there's no gray area with education there. It's for the students, you go because you have to go, and if you don't go, you won't get anywhere.
Right. That's interesting. Okay. I want to turn to my audience now as well, because we have a group of youngsters here. A lot of you are, and some of you in high school, some of you at universities as well. For all of you, it's an open question. Do you really value education? Do you only go to school because you're told to by your parents? Or do you actually go there because you have something in you where you actually want to learn and gain knowledge? If we could just start from someone in the front row, my brother here, as you have the microphone, let's start with you. Do you value education?
It's good for just general knowledge, for voting and things like that.
Okay, but having said that, if you could just keep the microphone there as well. Having said that, there's so many aspects to education. It's not just for general knowledge. I mean, you're learning key skills in life as well. Do you think that youngsters who go to school really think about the real impact of education and how important it is?
I think when you're young, you don't really realize how important education is. So maybe you might take it lightly.
Okay, you know, that's definitely what a lot of the media say sometimes, that the youngsters don't really appreciate it more. Okay, let's get some more points of view. Let's see if you could just pass it back to, we have a hand up just there. Yeah, what would you like to say?
I can only really speak from a subjective point of view, but me personally, I think I have a deep, deep love for education almost, because it's instilled from the very youth, because I immigrated here from Pakistan. So, okay. And as an Andean in Pakistan, you understand the difficulties that you have getting an education. And being in the Andean Muslim community, you're told time and time again how, you know, we're limited there and our possibilities are limited there. So now here, it almost feels like you have a duty to your parents who brought you here to strive to gain that education, because they worked that hard and they actually pushed themselves to come here with almost nothing, only so you can have an education. So because of their struggle, you see, it's almost as if there's a love in me to seek education.
Okay, all right, exactly, thank you for that. Dawn, if I could just turn to you, what are the benefits of getting an education? Because unfortunately some schools are geared up to almost becoming a factory where they give a sort of stamp of approval just so that you could go out and getting a job. But looking at it from a broader perspective, how can we, when we're telling youngsters to get an education, what are the main benefits? What can you tell them?
Well, once I heard an interview with the abbot of a Zen monastery, and one of the candidate monks was going to leave the monastery. And he thought the abbot would be very angry, and the abbot said, no, I'm not angry. You are now a little awake. You will never entirely go back to sleep again. And I've always liked that, because what the abbot meant was that the education he'd received at the monastery had made him more awake to the possibilities of the world, better able to understand the world. He was more awake to the world. The more education you get, the more awake you are to those possibilities. This makes you a better person, a better citizen, and it actually makes you happier because you understand what's going on. The world isn't as much of a mystery to you. Second benefit is commercial. In the modern world, knowledge equates to jobs, one way or another. If you have an education, you will be able to get a job. It may not be the job of your dreams, but you will be able to get a job. Without an education, now that we've moved into the knowledge age, that will almost be impossible. The old factory jobs where you're screwing nut A onto bolt B will be done by robots.
Okay, yeah, that's a very good way of looking at it. To one extent, that maybe seems like a fair thing, where someone who doesn't have access to education has come to a developed country where the education system is quite good. They've learned these skills, and obviously they're going to come back to their home country to make sure that they can actually use those skills to the benefit of their own people. So, you know, you can't really say anything against that, can you?
It's kind of hard to say. Globalization and technology has really turned things up to a level that is just, it's unmatched by anything else, and students have access to so much, and the ability to gain that knowledge and to put it to use anywhere in the world is really, for some people, quite easy to do.
Mm. So, Dawn, just turning to you, I mean, we're talking about developing countries. How important do you think education is in developing a country?
Incredibly important. I was in Colombia in 2007. And they're planning on using cell phones, smartphones, to educate their population. One of the places they're starting with are the district nurses, and they will upgrade them on the latest techniques for combating diseases and public health issues and that. So, developing countries are putting a very high priority on education, but also they're short of money and trying to do it on not very much money. Mm. So. It's difficult for them, but yeah, they're trying as hard as they can.
It's interesting that you just touched on the area of money. Yeah, Mubarak Sahib, please.
The problem is that when these educated people go back to their country, they do not have the jobs over there. The jobs are not there.
They don't have the same
and
infrastructure.
And they are already
well,
used to living in the Western Hemisphere, in America or in Europe, and the easygoing life where they take electricity and all these things for granted.
For granted, yeah.
And they cannot go back to the Stone Age.
That's right.
And the problem is they get there and get disillusioned, and the politicians, you know, drive them out as if they have come to capture their political seats and all that. And so they are frustrated and they go back. Mm. This is a drain. So unless these two things go hand in hand, education as well as the the infrastructure of those
societies as well.
Countries.
Yeah.
Because I've seen so many Sierra Leoneans here who are doctors and engineers, but they have no place over there. If they go back, they would be left without any job.
That's right.
Or a job which will really will not
but
be
at the
worth.
Same time, the governments of those countries can easily
say
they are
worried about their children.
They
go to their school, you know, where children have to walk for miles and miles. So what about their children?
Yeah.
So it's just a spiral sort of thing, and to come out of that vicious circle
that is very
really
difficult.
Needs proper guidance, and we are very happy that we are guided by a caliph, and we know what to do, and he looks at all the world from another angle, from a much wider angle, and he's able to tell the Africans and the other people what to do and what not to do, and how to gain supremacy in education.
That's right.
Again, coming back to the education, our youngsters, well, I'm happy that in our Ahmadiyya Muslim community, we are a community that is as far as education is concerned, we are one of the highest, you know, immigrants. All our students are educated. If a student doesn't go to school, we go to the parents, we find out what's the problem, and if there is a monetary problem, we solve that problem. Mm. Because these are our tomorrow. This is they have to give some benefit to the world. Education should not only be for a job. It should be primarily for service to humanity. As far as job, you will get it anyway. But when the motive is that my I'm getting this education, I'm becoming a doctor, so that I can serve humanity, then you know the dividend is absolutely very, very large.
That's a good perspective. I mean, don't you just touch on the cost of education, and I want to get the audience's perspective on this, because globally this is a big debate, the rising cost of education, and who should pay for this education? Should it be the students who are going to university, because obviously they're the ones who are benefiting from it, but from a larger perspective, obviously society as a whole benefits from it as well. So there are those people who argue that actually society, whether it's through tax or government funding, should pay for education. So we had some more hands up as well. Yes, just the brother over there.
Well, I just wanted to mention that there's a twofold problem here, not just the rising cost of education, but also the inflation of the amount of education we need.
Right.
For example, maybe 10, 15 years ago, it would take much less time to become a practical person in the job market.
Okay.
It takes 4 years of an undergrad degree, and then 4 years of maybe graduate school, maybe for doctoring, and then to get a job, actually.
Okay. All right, thank you for that comment. We had one more hand raised at the back. If you could just give it to brother just there in the last row. Yes, what would you like to add?
Yeah, I'd just like to say that we're all sitting here talking about having that thirst for education, but along with that thirst, you have to remember that it becomes hard work. And with hard work, usually our grades go up, and there's always scholarships that are offered. So I think that does cut some of the burden, and as long as we desire that education, our marks will remain high, and we're always rewarded a certain percentage of our tuition as a scholarship.
Okay, all right, thank you for those comments. Turning back to the panelists, this is a big hot discussion all over the world. Even in the UK just last year, we had big student protests over the rising costs in university, because just over the last 6-7 years, I mean, university fees used to be about £1,000 a year. And then the next government said, actually, no, we'll raise it up to £3,000 a year. And then just recently, they've announced that it can go up as high as £9,000 a year. So just within a few years, the cost has gone up so high. Idris, I'm just turning to you. Who do you think should pay for this?
Well, I mean, first of all, I would like to make a comment on the cost of education. If we, you know, I usually have this beautiful quote, if you think the cost of knowledge is too high, think about ignorance. Ignorance, you have to pay in the long run heavily. So I don't think, you know, gaining knowledge, you know, at significant cost is especially what we are paying today, is too high.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there is a cost to it, and there are things, you know, people have to do. Some people can afford it, some people cannot afford it. And there are mechanisms in Canada, as well as I've seen in European countries, there are mechanisms for those who cannot afford. There are scholarships, there are awards that you, if you excel, you show that you have the drive and you can do the you can be the best, you can get those, that free money to get that education. There are a number of them in Canada, and I usually guide those students who come to me and talk about that we can't afford it, and this is how we can help them.
Just turning to you, I mean, we're talking about the growing cost of education, and like Ajaz just mentioned there, that some people can afford it and some people can't. So isn't this just adding to the sort of rich and poor divide within a society?
Perfectly true, and I'm going to make a purely economic argument here. As I said before, we've entered the knowledge age. The economic engine that will drive Canada and most of the Western industrialized countries in the future is the ability to produce and manipulate new knowledge, to handle knowledge in one way or the other, and to provide, to make it useful in various ways. So our governments are acting in, to a certain extent, in opposition to their own best interests by raising university tuition fees. They should be doing as much as they can to lower them, because the better educated a population we have, the more people we will have that can contribute to that knowledge age economic engine. As I say, that's a purely economic argument,
right,
but it's a good one. So yeah. I agree that the tuition fees should be lower and that it is in the government's best interest to do that.
Yeah. What's your perspective on this? What's your personal view?
It's pretty simple. You know, if anyone said, would you rather pay this much or pay nothing for education, you'd say, oh, I don't want to pay anything for education, yeah, obviously, or much less.
But someone has to pay for it at the end of the day.
Of course, yes,
exactly.
Of course.
That's the main issue.
In your case, or what's happening in the UK, it seems a little bit out of control, I think, perhaps, if the tuition costs are going that high, because I think the higher it goes, the more people will have a hard time trying to pay that off. And I do think that the government needs to step in and do something about that.
It's quite interesting the way they base their regulation. As I said, you can the maximum is £9,000. So now what's happened is some universities are offering the same course, but they'll charge £100 less. So, and there's almost this sort of commercial aspect that's come in, where they're trying to sort of, you know, fight for places. But at the same time, you know, there are massive amounts of people who want to go to universities, and the universities are saying that to be able to provide these courses, we have to get funding from somewhere, and it's just out of necessity that's why it's happened.
I think there has to be a balanced approach. I think someone has to pay, and raising tuition fees high, making them high, will discourage a lot of people from getting that education. But supporting it through tax dollars, through government funding, will encourage a lot of other people. But if you make it completely free, everything that comes for free, people don't value it. So there has to be some cost to the students, and there has to be some supplement from the government, which Canada is trying to do, especially in Ontario recently. Mm-hmm. They have promised, and I hope they will live up to their promises, that they will pay 30% of the students' tuition fees. And that will, where will it come from? From the tax dollar.
Are you actually saying that something you just mentioned, that actually having some financial investment in it by yourself makes the students value
their education a lot more?
Yeah, okay. I mean, we've got some students here, so yeah. Just before turning to them, yeah.
I just had to relate to a lot of my brothers here that I've obviously went through the education system just as they have, and I had to pay the same tuition that they had to pay. Probably maybe a little bit less, but
right.
My parents couldn't afford it, and I was kind of stuck with the point of thinking about, well, how do I do this? I mean, and then the brother at the back talking about hard work and education in academics is absolutely right. My hard work kind of had to translate into the working world, where I thought I need to take up a part-time job or work full-time in the summer, get that tuition money, pay it, and then do my education. So,
and do you think you benefited from that?
I benefited from that in with respect to not having debt to pay off, or Ontario loans that were given to me. I didn't have to worry too much.
It's interesting
about that,
because there's some people who stay in the university environment that I know, especially in the UK, where they'll do one degree, and then they'll do another one because there's almost this safety net that you'll get government funding to a certain extent. You can take out a loan, you can do another 3-year degree, and then you don't have to go into the job market, because you can almost just keep learning and staying within that environment, because there's a cold world out there to get, it's a hard life to actually get a job sometimes, yeah. And some people maybe take that a bit too far. But the interesting point you mentioned there, Jasub, that having a financial investment in your own education makes you concentrate and value a bit more. And I want to open this up to the audience here, because a lot of you are maybe investing a lot of money into your education. Do you think this actually makes you concentrate a lot more? You're thinking, hang on, I'm investing thousands of dollars into this, so I better make sure I do a good job and make sure I don't mess up my exams. Let's get someone from brother over here. What do you think? Are you in education at the moment? Are you a university? If you could just pass the microphone to you.
Well, you have to think more, to take, in case of education, you have to take chances. You have to take courses that, might take you far or, maybe behind. So if there's not enough funds, then you kind of stay back, hold yourself. So you really can't take any risk.
Okay.
So.
Okay. Just very briefly, I want to get another perspective. Do you ever think when you're going through exams that actually, I've invested this money and I better do well? Does that put pressure on you? Does that help you to excel? We've got hand raised up just at the front here. If you could just pass the microphone there. Maybe that's a bad pressure. Maybe that's extra pressure that you don't need.
Yeah, actually, most of the money nowadays is electronic. You don't actually see the money, okay. And everything is done electronic. So most of the money that I get from OSAP
I don't even see it. So I don't really get the feeling sometimes that I'm paying for university because I don't see the money. So there are times, what I'm trying to say is it's easy to forget that you're paying for so much money for each course because you don't actually see it. But you constantly have to remind yourself, look, I am paying a lot for this, right? So you have to try.
Okay, all right, thanks for that. We're coming to the end of this first half, so thank you for your input as well. To the viewers at home, stay with us. We're going to be coming back with part two, where we're going to be having a look at the actual education system as a whole. Is it really working? What can we do to reform it as well? And what changes maybe need to be made so that we can keep up with the modern world and all of its changes? So stay with us. We'll be back with part two after this short break. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to this edition of Real Talk Canada. On today's show, we're looking at education, and in part two of the program, we're going to be having a look at the education system itself. Does it really work, and maybe does it actually need reform? So let's start this discussion. And Dawn, if I could just turn to you first. Do you think the education system actually prepares students to work in an international arena? Because today we almost look at this world as a global village. And how well do you think the education system is working within that?
Well, there's two aspects of that. First of all, the global arena. We have, in Canada, a bilingual country, English and French, and yet many of the students graduate from high school innocent of the knowledge of French, even though they've been taught it. That's rather a shame, and we need more language instruction for a globalized world. In terms of education for the modern economy, our educational system was designed for the industrial age during the industrial age. We're now in the knowledge age. One of the key things is innovation, and we give the students very little opportunity to be innovative. That has to change.
Okay. Joseph, yeah.
I think Don brings a very good point that yes, we do, you know, give students life skill to survive in an industrial age, but we are entering what today everybody is terming as the knowledge age. And we are not doing enough on that side.
Okay, Barbara, just turning to you, I mean, working in an elementary school at the moment, you see the education system on a day-to-day level.
Yeah.
Do you think it's actually working? Are you happy with the system at the moment?
Because I'm at elementary, I feel like what we're doing with the students is we're working with them at the ground level and with the roots, and we're trying to build, you know, the character traits within them to prepare them for, you know, high school or even university, and even after that, the things that they carry throughout their whole lives. And it's really basic things, but those are the things we're trying to hone in on and to really prepare them for later on.
I mean, if you look at the education system maybe in the 1950s or 60s, it was very teacher orientated, where the teacher would almost spoon feed information to the students, and the students in the classroom, there's individual learning. It wasn't maybe as group based, where the students had to just memorize facts. I guess that's what it was. And I mean, if you look at examinations nowadays, it's not sort of what is this, but it's analyze this or explain this and examine this. And why do you think the move has been made towards that style of education? Dawn, maybe if you could throw some light on that.
A couple of years ago I met with some principals from secondary schools in Singapore. Now, Singapore always scores very highly on the international tests. And they said they're very proud of that, but businesses are coming to them and saying, students can't solve problems in the real world. And that is really what we have to do. We don't really need people who solve problems in school. That's not of much use. We need people who can solve problems in the real world. That's what benefits humanity. But those are unstructured problems with no known solutions. And that takes practice and a different kind of thinking than we currently teach.
Mm. And I think the thing you mentioned about spoon feeding, there are education systems in the world right now that do that. And, you know, I grew up in one of them where teachers would spoon feed. Students will, you know, heavily depend on the teachers, but there comes a day when that spoon is not there. So I think one of the things I have seen in while coming into the Western world is that, you know, here what they try to do is they try to make you an independent learner, and that's very much valued, and that helps you with the skills to solve real world problems, because now you are a learner. When you graduate from a university, from a college, or whatever program you are in, you have been an independent learner. You go out and you find and learn about the related problems and can solve those problems.
I remember I always used to have this issue with independent learning, because when I was at university, my lecturers always used to tell me that it's your job to go and read these books, it's your job to do the research. And I was sat there in lectures thinking, hang on, I'm paying you to teach me, so why aren't you teaching me? And it's only afterwards now that I've really understood that it's to build that inspiration in you to actually go there and find those questions and answers to those questions yourself. But Mark Naziz, I'm just turning to you, what would be your comments?
I have got more experience from third world countries. And sometimes, you know, students talk about the price of education and talk about this and talk about that. I wish some of them could have gone to those remote parts of Africa, and they've seen how those children, how those students value education. And they almost become your servant if you are teaching them. I have seen countless people who came to our homes when I was there, and they would leave their son and said, just teach him how to read and write. Right. And he would be a servant, almost a servant. Because they value education very much. Mm. And here, you know, sometimes we should also, you know, the world has become a global village. You make a doctor here, and the next day the doctor goes to the US, United States. So all the money that was spent by the Ontario government or whatever government here, well, the drain is there. Yeah. And so you could go to Europe, and you could go to other parts of the world. So it's a very complicated system, and the world should start thinking globally. And this difference of education which is there in the developing countries, that also has to be taken care of. Yeah. Those extremely intelligent students, I have seen exceptionally, their IQ extremely high. But they've got no education, they do not have the facility. And here you have, you know, the libraries, and you have the internet, and you have the Google and all that, all those things. We must be thankful that the gracious God has blessed us to be in a country where we have such educational facilities. Okay. Yes, the fees is high, no doubt. But make way hay while the sun shines, because it could be higher tomorrow.
Okay, yeah, Jasam, you'd like to start something?
You know, coming back to the point you're talking about is if the system is working.
Right.
I think for the system to work, you know, there are a number of players that have to play their role. There's the government, there is, you know, the regulations, there's the public, and there's the university system. You know, I say this quite often, that go to any country of the world, a medical doctor will always have a job, because the profession is heavily regulated. The number of seats are defined, and people coming, and that's why everybody wants to aspire to become a doctor.
Right.
You know, they want to get into, they try to work hard to get into, some of them can get in, some of them they can't. And because the number, the seats are limited and all the infrastructure is in place, and that's why you will not find somebody. But that is not being done for other professions.
Okay.
If, you know, infrastructures could be in place for those and everything, the system will work in all aspects of the society. Okay. But that is not there.
Right. I want to get some of the audience's perspective on this as well. And we've got some hands raised. Yeah, just the brother at the back there. You could just pass the microphone to him. Just in the black sweater there.
I think learning is also a very subjective thing, because looking back to high school and stuff, I think they started introducing new ways of teaching children, because everyone's different, everyone learns in a different way. So now they've introduced group-based projects, they've introduced different kinds of things to help the student learn in many different ways. Reflecting back to my first year, I remember when in one of my classes, I did not understand a concept, like professor tried explaining this concept and I did not understand her. So what I did was I actually went out to the internet, and I used YouTube to understand that concept. So I think learning has to be a very subjective thing. It's a very subjective thing, so everyone has to learn the way they can. Like, they have to figure out a way that suits them the best.
That's a very good point. I think the education system has mainly developed to incorporate that. Yes, what would you like to add?
I personally think that the Canadian system works quite well, because especially in high school, whenever you took tests or exams, they would split them up into sections: knowledge, application, thinking, and communication. Knowledge would be what you were talking about beforehand, where they just teach you to memorize something and whether you know the facts or not.
Yeah, exactly.
But then application would be whether you could apply those facts and knowledge. And then thinking would be a problem that you'd never seen before, and you had to figure out kind of maybe a real world, or you know, more like the real world situation where it's not a structured problem, you have to figure it out. And then communication would be another important aspect of the real world, where you have to be able to communicate your knowledge, you know, and actually express that you are a learned individual. And I've seen this carried over in university as well, although they don't clearly define the sections. Mm-hmm. I've seen an emphasis in this, you know, teaching where they teach you to apply your skills rather than just knowing the facts.
Okay, all right, exactly. What about just the gentleman there on, right, just next to you there with the glasses? Are you at a university or are you at high school?
No, I'm still in high school.
Okay, okay. And what do you think in terms of the education system there in high school? Does it actually engage students? Does it make you want to learn? Is it motivating enough? What do you think?
Again, I'm also part of the International Baccalaureate Program. Mm-hmm. Basically, I think that it does challenge you, and there are, as mentioned before, it's a lot more intensive, so there is a lot more learning. The focus, again, what I like is that it's not as knowledge-based as the regular high school program.
Right.
A lot of it is more applying your knowledge and thinking beyond. So I think in that sense, it is very useful. And basically, I think that the Ontario and Canadian education level should start moving towards that.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Thanks for that. I mean, just turning back to the panel, obviously we've heard some positive views there, but I mean, if you just open up any newspaper, there's always issues of bad discipline in school, the problems faced by immigration into the country, the people joining your schools who maybe cannot even talk the local language. And I mean, Whiteside, if I could just turn to you, what are the challenges that teachers face within education?
It's tough because in the classroom, in any classroom, the teacher has to face with, has to deal with students from, like you mentioned, all over the world, really.
Yeah, yeah.
And the students that have just gotten here, obviously, like you said, may not speak English very well. And it's up to the teacher to kind of really to dig deep and look at what resources and what teaching strategies will be able to get through to these students that maybe don't know English very well.
Dawn, just turning to you, do you think standards in education have fallen? I mean, looking at it from a general perspective, do you think we're really improving, or maybe we're going in the wrong direction?
Well, people have been saying standards have been falling for a long, long time. I would say more standards are changing. As we realize we need new skills and different kinds of knowledge than we used to, then we change our standards and we start looking for new things, but sometimes we don't change them quickly enough. For example, when I was in high school, part of my physics tests and exam was how well I could use a slide rule. Now, I suspect that most people here would fail that today because it's a valueless skill. You would now use a calculator, but you might be tested on whether you could solve problems appropriately using a calculator. So using old standards and looking at how I would do on things like that, or how you would do on things like that, really isn't very meaningful in today's world. But yes, we do have to watch that we don't let standards slip.
Well, Barak Nazisa, I just want to bring you into the discussion because we're talking about challenges faced by teachers, and within the media, they're always highlighting bad discipline or bad behavior of students, because at the end of the day, you know, these are youngsters and they're building their own moral foundation. In terms of morality, is that something that the teachers should teach at school? Is that something that they learn from parents?
Well, morality, the teacher is their mentor. Mm-hmm. And I remember that we learned good behavior from our teachers in college. And so a teacher has to be very careful because the students are watching him or watching her.
Yeah.
And if a teacher is not a good person, and the students, that's what they are. And many of the ways I used to teach in Africa, I acquired those ways from my teachers in Rabwa, the way we were taught in Rabwa. So it's important also for the parents, that the parents, if they have this, you know, our father died in Africa, and we were six brothers, left orphans in Rabwa. My mother would compromise on everything, but she would never compromise that we don't go to school. Mm-hmm. That was something, you know, she would not agree, whatever happened. And the result is that many doctors and engineers and all that, you know. So it's very important that the parents also are very, very particular. And the teachers also perform their responsibility. They are the builders of the nation, and people watch them very carefully. They should comport themselves. You hear these news once in a while in the newspapers, teachers, you know, having relationship with children,
right,
having this and that. And sometimes, very recently, there was a news that people were giving, you know, schools a few $1,000 just to get good marks so that they're able to go to the university.
Right, right.
So, well, if this thing, you know, starts, this is a very, very poor, you know,
right,
impression.
That's right. Yeah, just Joseph.
I think, you know, both the parents and this, the teachers have to play a role in mm-hmm. terms of morality. Parents give them very, you know, initial foundations of morality, what morality is. But they come to school when they're very vulnerable. And they are very, you know, you can change them, you can make them adapt to different things. So yeah, teachers have a lot of influence on them. Teachers can do a lot of things.
But at the same time, the teachers are then saying that we have so much responsibility to do in terms of teaching. Why do we have this extra responsibility of teaching certain morals, and maybe they're not even the right people to teach these morals?
Yeah, no, in terms of not, you know, not just teaching them morals, but they have to have a moral behavior. You don't just learn from what is being taught.
Okay.
It's a whole scheme of things. When a teacher-student relationship starts, students learn their habits. You will see that many of the time, at least especially on the young age, and even at the university level, I have seen that students that love a teacher, they will imitate him. They will try to follow everything he does. Sometimes, you know, just scratching your cheek in the way your teacher does, because you are impressed by the teachers. Mm-hmm. The way they have transferred the knowledge, they have an impact on you, and you try to be like him. And so the moral aspect is much broader than just teaching in the classroom.
Right.
And that's why, you know, we have background checks for the teachers, all those things available, because the students mm-hmm. at that age are very vulnerable, yep, and the teachers have a lot of influence. Okay. So we have that things in place, but still sometimes there are cracks.
All right, and thanks. Whitechester, just turning to you, I mean, you yeah. as a teacher yourself,
that's right,
you know, what's your personal view on this?
It's you know, Dr. Rose, you made a great point. It's both people's responsibility. It's the parents, it's also the teachers. I mean, for a lot of students, you see the teacher for 7-8 hours of your day.
Yeah, that's right.
And then you go home, and sometimes you'll see your parents, sometimes you won't. Depends what your parents are doing or where your parents are, whether they're working or not. And a lot of the times, what I've found is, you know, if your parents are home, they're busy, you know, cooking or cleaning or fixing, or well, they have a lot of jobs around the house that need to be taken care of. So there is a big emphasis on the teacher to, you know, if the student makes mistakes or gets into, you know, a bad situation, the teacher's there to kind of...
Yeah. It'll be interesting to ask you, actually, when you were training to become a teacher, were you actually taught how to help in the development of a child's character, not just in terms of teaching them the syllabus,
right,
but actually
right.
helping them to develop into a mature adult?
It's a tricky thing, because I don't recall ever being taught, you know, this is how you mold a student, or this is how you shape them, or this is how you correct things if they go wrong. There's a lot of content for it, and it's something that is really hard to get that across to the teacher, or to kind of allow that to teach them.
Yeah. Okay. Dawn, just turning to you as well, I mean, what's your view on this about the morality of teachers and how they should actually influence their students?
Well, it's very similar to what's already been said, in that there's a practical component and an ideal component. The practical component, as just has been said, teachers have a limited amount of time with the students and very little time individually with individual students. That limits the amount they can do in some ways. The parents and the family and the cultural surround of the child has a huge impact on that. And teachers can be influential, yes, but it is limited compared to the effect of the total cultural surround.
Okay, let's move on to the audience now as well, because obviously you've gone through this schooling system and you've developed into, you know, mature adults as well. And do you think that your teacher was actually responsible for that? Maybe it was the people that you experienced in your religious environment, your religious community, or maybe your parents at home. Who was actually responsible in actually molding you into sort of, you know, moral members of society? The brother at the back, what would you like to add to that?
Definitely it's both parents and teachers, but I think it's more and more a teacher, which kind of gives you a role model to go towards a positive side, I guess.
So. Okay. Yes, we have a hand up there.
I think the pressure is kind of change as you go on throughout the system. At the elementary school level, the pressure is from the parents. The parents make you do the homework and whatnot. And then you get into the high school. And then at the high school, the pressure is to get into a university. And then at the university level, it's the economic and the financial pressure that we were talking about before. You know, that plays a great deal. That plays a great role in the pressure that you get there, because you're writing an exam and you can't fail the class because you $500, you know, $1,000 for that single class. So, and then there's also the pressure, as Osman was talking about, of getting a job. So I think there's pressure all throughout life. It's just the different types of pressure that you're dealing with throughout your educational career.
Thank you. Just turning back to the panel, Whiteside, if I could just turn to you, what kind of, do you think maybe your students, even at elementary level, are under pressure to do well? And what advice do you give them in terms of their learning, whether it's exams or whatever it is?
First of all, absolutely the pressure is there. The pressure, it comes from all directions, from home, from the parents, sometimes from the teachers as well, and also their own peers. When you see that, and you see that in the students and how they're reacting in terms of their scores or their grades, sometimes if students aren't doing so well, it's important to kind of pull them aside and to let them know that they're okay, and that they have other chances to improve, to make sure that mental collapse doesn't happen with these students, and you know, that they have multiple opportunities to continue to succeed.
Ms. Phillips, just turning to you, I mean, we have a number of youngsters who watch this program, and what advice can you give them about how to deal with that pressure within education?
Well, nothing like hard work to solve a lot of those problems, but there's a difference between working hard and working effectively. So if someone is not succeeding in school, they should take advice from someone. Usually their teacher would be the first person to turn to find out what they could do to improve their work. But there's a second aspect to this. There's an overuse of tests and exams because they're easy to mark. Mm-hmm. There are other ways of assessing people that we need to explore for the 21st century. Many of you follow sports. I'll use North American baseball as an example. Those teams don't pick the players on the basis of a multiple choice test. Instead, they look at what's called performance-based assessment. How many hits they make, how many runs they make, how many errors they make, and other statistics. This creates a profile of the strengths and weaknesses of the individual in that particular field of endeavor. We can do the same thing in the schools, and if you put certain aspects of education online, it can be done automatically in real time. Mm-hmm. The students can find out at any instant how they're doing, and that can be very powerful in influencing what they do and how they do it.
Okay. Yes, it's also yes, please.
It brings about a very good point. These days in the universities, they are using this clicker technology, where you know you're getting on you know, real time feedback. The teacher is getting that real time feedback from the students who is teaching, how much they are absorbing, what they are doing, and how they are doing, and they, he can gear his lectures, his transmission of knowledge. Accordingly, and make it more effective.
Yeah.
More effective teaching as well as effective learning is what we need to do.
Okay, Mubarak Naziz, I'm just turning to you. I mean, what advice do you give students who are currently in education in terms of how they can improve their grades? And is there any teaching within Islam to help you sort of through the tests and through the challenges that you face in education?
You see, we have discussed for almost an hour on different aspects of education, the fees, the jobs, but I was thinking that what type of scholars does the Muslims want? Does the Ahmadiyya Muslim community want? What type of scholars? The Holy Prophet has spoken about two types of scholars. One, he has said, there are some scholars
who will be like the worst creation on the under the canopy of the earth. Tahta adimas samai. They will be the worst people, such scholars. But he said, Ulamao ummati kambiyai bani Israel. That scholars of my community will be like the biblical prophets. They will be pious people, honorable people. So acquiring education to become a scholar has got responsibilities. The promised Messiah has written in one of his books, in many of his books, in Fatah Islam, he has written that he is extremely worried that students go to colleges and universities, and before they have finished their education in the universities, they have already become disillusioned about Islam, disillusioned about God. So that is not the type of scholars the Ahmadiyya Jamaat wants. We want scholars who remain indebted and who understand what Islam is. If we do not get that knowledge, so that you go and come back and become disillusioned and you become indifferent, we are making an investment with our youngsters that they become champions and they become scholars. That is why the promised Messiah has said that one revelation, وَجَائِلُ الَّذِينَ تَبَعُوكَ فَوْكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِلَىٰ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, that members of my community will always excel others till the day of resurrection. He said, this prophecy was revealed to me so many times that only Allah knows the count.
Okay.
He said, it was hammered into me. So rest assured that you make a little effort and God is going to reward you. We want scholars who will give service to humanity, who are good human beings, who are good to their country, who are good to their children, who are good to their community, who are good to themselves.
Okay, all right, Jazakallah. Are we coming to the end of the program? But Jazakallah Mubarak Sahib for that point. I'm sure that will be really inspirational for everyone at home. It's also just saying to you, what would be your final concluding remarks for the whole discussion that we've had today?
Well, I think we have to seek knowledge for the sake of knowledge, because knowledge is power. And with that power, you can do a lot of things in life. You can lead a successful life and become an excellent person, because with knowledge comes piety, as well as good skills to live in the society, this life. But one of the things I would really like to emphasize is you got to take the commercial aspect out of it. Mm-hmm. Seek knowledge for the sake of knowledge, because that will help you all through your life.
Okay, Abdul-Razzaq, what would you like to add in as a concluding remark?
Just for those students who aren't the ones who excel all the time and who maybe struggle here and there or find those difficult times in their educational career, to not just the cliche, don't give up, but to look for ways to improve and to look for those people to talk to, as Don was mentioning. Those sources of help will absolutely shape you, realign you, and will help guide you in the right direction.
Okay. And Don Phillips, what would you like to add in at the end?
Well, as we move into the knowledge age, education becomes more important. Period. It's as simple as that. Education will make you a better person. It will help you to understand the world. And we're all going to have to become lifelong learners, because knowledge changes.
Okay. All right. Thank you to all of our panel. Jazakallah. Thank you to all the audience as well for your points of view. I know some of you wanted to add some points in at the end, but unfortunately we've come to the end of the program, and I hope for our viewers at home it's been an informative program. I hope you've really understood the value of education, and sometimes it's something we have to remind ourselves that we shouldn't take this for granted. A lot of us who live in developed countries have access to education, and we always have to make sure that we make the most of it. At the end, I'd also like to thank all of the people who work behind the scenes as well. This program cannot happen without them. There are a lot of volunteers who have made this program possible, so I'd really like to thank them for their help and their efforts throughout the series. For our viewers watching at home, don't forget you can always get in touch with us as well. Visit our website, mta.tv/realtalk, where you can actually find past episodes of the show and find out what we'll be discussing in the future. So make sure you check that out. And also you can email us directly on realtalk@mta.tv. I hope you've enjoyed the program. Make sure you stay with us for future programs of Real Talk. But from myself and the whole team, Assalamu alaikum.